Thank you for that very kind introduction. It's really a pleasure to be here at Elon College, Elon University. I used to know, had an old friend, Ann Bolin, who taught here, and she grounded into my head over the years that it was Elon College, but I know it's Elon University now. It's lovely to walk around your campus today and meet some students and faculty and staff. And I really appreciate the invitation and all of the co-sponsors that I know it takes to put on an event like this. The title of my talk, More Men, is really kind of a takeoff from something that was said to me when the book came out on a friend of mine from high school said on Facebook. He's very nice to sort of advertise my work. He says, oh, Mike has come out with a new book, and it's called Some Men. It's about men who engage in anti-violence work. Let's hope that Mike's next book will be called More Men. This would be a growing thing. So I took off on that, and I think, well, that's a very nice thing to, very optimistic way to kind of think about the book and about what the book is all about. I wanted to today say a few things about the genesis of the book and the context within which we worked on the book, my two co-authors and I, and then I'll say a few things about focusing mostly on today. This is a kind of contemporary history book from the 1970s to the present, but I'm going to focus more on what's going on today with the younger generation of men who are getting involved in anti-violence work. I'll give you a portrait of one guy who I want to focus in on to give you sort of an idea of a trajectory of, into anti-violence work by a younger man. And then at the end, I'm going to talk a little bit about how we can think about the vast majority of young men that I meet and probably all of you meet today who I think of themselves as good men, and how good men can become more engaged in acting in the world in good, positive sorts of ways. So to start with, these are my two co-authors, Tal Peretz on the left, Max Greenberg on the right. Tal is now, they both came to work with me at USC as graduate students to work on their PhDs, but as undergraduates, they had been involved in doing campus organizing with men around feminist issues, around anti-violence issues, and they both kind of got to me around the same time as my PhD students, and I started to learn from both of them that they were involved in these growing new networks of younger men, both locally on their campuses and then nationally as well, who were engaged in having conversations about men and feminism and masculinity and violence. And as I talked more with them, it conjured memories from when I was in graduate school, which was back in the dark ages, I guess. I don't know, the late 70s through the early 80s, when I got connected with men in my community who were doing similar kinds of work, and in the United States as well, who were doing similar kinds of work. So we cooked up this idea of doing a study across generations and try to learn what we can learn about the experiences of men from the 70s, 80s, and forward who engaged themselves with feminism, who engaged themselves with working to end violence against women. Tal on the left now, he is a professor at Auburn University. Max is a professor at Boston University. So I'm very proud of both of them, and it was a pleasure working with them on this project. So I wanted to put in a good strong pitch for them, because all of the work for this book is really from the three of us here, but I'll talk as though it's mine from here on, and I hope they'll do the same when they talk about the book. So some things about the context when we were writing this book, really kind of done with the research, or still maybe doing some of the research, but starting to write it up, was a lot of stuff just started popping in the United States around sexual violence and domestic violence and other forms of gender-based violence. A lot of stuff started popping in the news around the National Football League and domestic violence issues, and the way the league had apparently engaged in a cover-up of a lot of the domestic violence problems. In the military, all kinds of reports were coming out about the military, not just 2014 here, but 2015 as well, and 2016. Domestic violence rates among, you know, multiply deployed Iraq and Afghanistan veterans, sexual violence within military schools, sexual harassment in military schools, and so a lot of news started to happen. In addition, there was a lot popping in the news about sexual violence on campuses, and you had a national push to start addressing sexual violence issues on campuses that was really started at the grassroots by students. I think lots of people point to Occidental College, which is in my neighborhood in the Los Angeles area, as kind of sparking this new conversation, mostly by young women who had experienced sexual assaults on their campuses and then found that their universities and their campus administrations were, in their view, kind of shoving the stuff under the carpet rather than bringing it out into the light of day and trying to figure out how to prevent it. And they started networking with other students on other campuses, and suddenly you have a national conversation going on, which is kind of a new thing compared to the generation I started studying back in the 70s and 80s. With social media today, those kind of things can take off like wildfire, and this actually did take off like wildfire. So at the national level, you have, you know, President Obama addressing this. At the state level where I live, you have the governor and other people in the state legislature addressing this in terms of colleges and universities. And the study that we did really for this book is really about grassroots organizing by everyday people. But I did want to say here that it's really important that leadership is very important as well. Women's leadership and men's leadership, adult leadership. And when you have, we know that research that's been done on workplaces and sexual harassment in workplaces, that when you have a leader in the workplace who is a male, who uses his sort of sense of entitlement and privilege to talk about women, to sexualize women, to talk about what he can do or has done to women, it sets a template for others in that organization. That increases the likelihood of sexual harassment happening. So I saw that happening when I was an athlete, and I had a coach one time. He used to like to brag about how many women he had screwed. And it created a template in our group for guys to be much more open in talking about that. When you have a leader who doesn't tolerate that and demands respect for women in male groups, it creates a different kind of atmosphere and template. We see this with Fox News right now, where you had the head of Fox News within the last year or two getting in all kinds of hot water for sexual harassment in his workplace. And now we're finding out that culture of sexual harassment had trickled down into other members of that organization. So whether it's an organization like a sports team, or it's a university, or it's a media organization, or it's the White House, when you have somebody at the very top who brags about what they can do to women, or what they have done to women, or if they're entitled to do to women, it sets a kind of template for other conversations in that workplace and perhaps in the nation. So as a result of that kind of change, I think I'll be addressing that sort of thing a little bit later at the end. So my fonts kind of got moved around a little bit, but oh well. So anyway, while we're working on this book, there's multiple calls from the sports world, from journalists, from colleges and communities, the military, for men to engage themselves. And I did want to back up just one other quick thing about leadership. You see Joe Biden standing behind President Obama here. Joe Biden was, if anything, Obama, of course, was president, so he's standing forward. But behind him, Joe Biden probably has a much longer and distinguished career of engaging with issues of sexual violence, and he helped when he was a senator pass the Violence Against Women Act. So I think, you know, very important to recognize that kind of legacy. Biden and others calling on men to involve themselves in solving these kinds of problems and addressing what's men's role, what's men's responsibility in thinking about and stopping violence against women. More recently, since the book has come out, we've had some broader changes. I think a lot more of discussion continuing to sort of bubble on campuses, but also in the community and in the nation. So, you know, I went to the large women's march in Los Angeles, you know, that was held in D.C. and all over the country. And one of the things I was looking for as a sociologist who's interested in men's engagements is, you know, how are men engaging in this historical moment? And I saw a lot of men at this demonstration, and a lot of them were like this guy down here. They were young guys who were holding up signs, "Listen to her, I'm with her, I support women." And there's some guys down here who, I don't know if my pointer works too well, but labor union guys who were, you know, out there in their sort of pro-woman t-shirts, younger people who were engaged in some of the sort of same symbolism that you would see in recent years at what young people started to call slut walks when in response to a Canadian judge who told a woman who was sexually assaulted if she only hadn't dressed like a slut, she wouldn't have been assaulted. And this started a whole movement among young people, again, like wildfire throughout the world. Slut walks suddenly occurred, and this young woman here is, you know, sort of giving out those kinds of messages that you see very commonly at slut walks. So you see a lot of engagement, I think, with young people today, and I'll talk about that a little bit more at the end. But first, I wanted to talk just about the historical framework of the book, and I'm not going to talk about too much history, but I think it's quite important to set that as a foundation. This might look as though I'm starting to shift into a religious discussion, but it's really not that. This is a little 2x2 table that I'm setting up that was created by my co-author Max Greenberg, that the horizontal axis being a temporal frame of before violence and after violence, the vertical being who does what. We have up here originator or perpetrator, if you want to use that, of violence, recipient or target of violence. And when you think about the development of anti-violence work, especially anti-rape work, anti-sexual harassment work in the United States, you can think about women's back in the 60s and really by the early 1970s at a very grassroots level. And we chronicle this in the book, in one chapter of the book, where we focus on this older cohort now of people that we call the movement cohort. And they concern themselves with different parts of this of the problem. First of all, dealing with survivors of violence after violence occurs, creating women's shelters survivors of sexual violence, rape crisis centers, support groups, hotlines, helping people who are trying to survive having been assaulted by some form of what we now call gender-based violence. They weren't using that term back then. So a lot of energy goes into doing that with very, very little money. It's in people's living rooms. It's in people's garages where some of these kinds of things start up before there's nonprofits and businesses and so forth that are doing this work. You also have people addressing themselves to trying to think about how do we protect potential recipients of violence before it happens. So things like risk reduction on campuses, putting up lights so people are safer walking around at night, women's self-defense classes that start oftentimes in college campuses in the 1970s. I was in college in 1970 to 74, and there were already women's self-defense classes starting up on those campuses like mine. And then finally, women were involved in trying to think about what do you do about perpetrators after violence happens. And it was really through the 1960s into the early 1970s, we as a culture mostly didn't take rape and sexual assault very seriously, and that was reflected in our policing and in our legal system. My older sister was assaulted by her husband at one time in a form of domestic violence that's textbook. And she, after like three or four different incidents, she finally called the police, and they came, and one of her most nightmarish sort of memories was always listening to the police out on the porch talking to her husband and all of them laughing out on the porch. And then he comes back in and says, "Well, you know, I'm sorry, I won't do that again." And then a couple weeks later, he split her lip open, you know, as the violence had escalated. So a lot of work goes into, in the 70s and 80s, into pushing our legal system, judges, courts, the law, police, to take these kinds of things seriously and develop ways of dealing with sexual assaults and domestic violence after they have happened in responsible ways that are supportive of survivors, and that would involve also therapeutic interventions for survivors, but also, especially in the case of domestic violence, the first beginnings of therapy groups for men who are perpetrators of domestic violence to try to get them to think about masculinity issues. And a lot of those early ones, we interviewed people who helped start those groups, and some of them are still doing those groups in places like St. Louis, Missouri, Boston, and elsewhere. So this is women doing almost all of this work, okay? And occasionally with a male ally, for instance, in a police department or something like that. But men like me back then, who were moved by the stories that we were hearing from women, often came up to women and said, what can I do to help? How can I help? And the kind of response we got was often very much like the response that white liberals got during the civil rights movement when they came up to black people and said, what can I do? And they were told, you can't do anything. We're organizing our own community. If you really want to help, go back and talk to white people about racism. Go back and educate your own community about racism, okay? And so men were also told the same thing. Go talk to the boys. Go talk to the men. If men will stop raping women, if men will stop hitting women, then all this downstream work won't be necessary. Go upstream, in other words, and work upstream and try to deal with potential perpetrators. So violence prevention becomes, yes, some men have worked in these other fields, in the anti-violence field, but most men who've entered the field of anti-violence work in that sort of quadrant with, you know, how do we prevent violence? How do we have conversations with boys and men to eliminate or mitigate future acts of violence against women, okay? So that's the kind of framework that we're looking at historically and asking the question, how do men get involved in this work? What's their experience? What are the challenges faced by men when they do this work? What are the opportunities that we have when we see an increasing number of men involved in this work, which we do today? We see more and more young men working and moving into this work. This is a little bit hard to see, but it's only up here. It's kind of complicated, much less complicated than it seems, but it's just the ages of the men that we interviewed. We interviewed men whose birthdays were 1941. Oh, this one's, somehow my margins are moving a bit. This is supposed to be at the other end, 1991. So the youngest guy we interviewed was 22 when the time we interviewed him. The oldest guy was about 70. And we divided them into these three cohorts, which we call the movement cohort, the bridge cohort, and the professional cohort. And the idea being that we can look at these not as absolutely distinct sets of experiences, but what did these men in the movement cohort, how did they experience moving into doing anti-violence work at this time period when all of this activism was happening from the grassroots, when it's really a social movement that they're connecting to and getting inspired by? How did this sort of more middle-aged group of men engage in the 80s and 90s at a time when feminism as a movement, quote, in the streets is on decline, but you have the rise of these organizations like anti-violence offices on campuses and rape crisis centers in communities and the beginnings of foundations and nonprofits that run these sorts of things and fund them. And then also, toward the end of that period, the Violence Against Women Act in the United States that starts a trickle of money into community organizations, a little bit of which goes into prevention and funds some programs that we studied. And then this last cohort, which we call the professional cohort, not because all of the men who are doing this work today define themselves as professionals, but because they enter the work at a time when the work itself has become professionalized. It's in offices. There's set curricula. There's paid jobs and internships connected to them. There's a sort of professionalization of work that really started as a kind of figure it out as you go mass movement in the 1970s. What are the implications of that? What are the opportunities that young men have today that maybe they didn't have that back then? But what are some of the new limitations that they may have on the kind of work that they're doing? So just, you know, one quick glimpse at this movement cohort, and then I'll just skip right to the present, really. But it's really, you know, more than nostalgia for me to think back to and to interview some of these older men now. But I was a part of this organization, the California Anti-Sexist Men's Political Caucus, back in the 70s and 80s. And it really was a cohort of people who were influenced by and inspired by the women's movement and mentored by feminist women to figure out how to start doing this kind of work. Skipping forward several decades, you know, I'm really concerned and I want to focus today here on the experience of the younger men in current time who are engaged in this work. This is some men on my campus who took part a couple of years ago in a Take Back the Night event as part of a group called Men Care, which no longer exists. Men are now folded into another organization. That's sort of the story of campus organizations, that they kind of morph and change over time. But we have a good number of men at USC involved in doing this kind of work right now as well. But as I said at the outset, one of my main concerns here today is to think about and hopefully get you thinking more about how we can encourage and create context for young men today who think of themselves as good men to become more publicly engaged as allies in stopping violence against women, as these men here took that kind of a plunge and made that kind of a commitment. So there's whereas with that first movement cohort, there was really kind of just one trajectory. All those guys we interviewed just kind of came in through, quote, the movement. They were involved in the anti-Vietnam War movement. They were involved in feminism, some of them in gay rights movement. But they were all sort of movement-driven into doing anti-violence work with women. Today's men are a wider variety of men. They're more ethnically diverse, and they have different pathways into anti-violence work. And I should say that that original cohort of men was predominantly white, middle-class, college-educated men, disproportionately Jewish men, which I've always found very interesting. And I can talk about that later if you like. It's a little bit of a tangent, but I think it's a really fascinating thing. Still today, probably a disproportionate number of men who are involved in doing this work are Jewish men. Both of my co-authors, Tal and Max, are Jewish men. But here's the two pathways, just to go, kind of take it really quickly. And then I'm going to give you an example of a young man who is a young man of color and kind of give you an idea of his pathway into anti-violence work and the kind of work he's doing with boys. The white middle class younger men that we interviewed have, in general, a pathway that starts oftentimes with sensitizing experiences, which is what in psychological literature really refers to having had really some bad, awful, close-up experiences with violence. You saw your mother get beaten up maybe by your stepfather. You witnessed or witnessed the aftermath of your sister or your spouse or a good friend getting sexually assaulted. You yourself are a survivor of childhood sexual assault. In the case of a couple of the gay men that we interviewed, they were survivors of sexual assault when they were freshmen in college at campus parties. Okay, so, quote, sensitizing experiences that give you a sort of visceral kind of connection to the issue of gender-based violence. Then a lot of these young guys, the young white guys, took college courses in women's studies. And if anybody ever says to you, you know, women's and gender studies has already done its job, we don't need it anymore, here's one good empirical reason to come back with is that a really high proportion of people who are going out into the world and doing anti-violence work around gender-based violence routed through and learned their stuff in women's and gender studies courses, and often through campus activism that was connected to that, and then through community internships that are connected to the programs that they're in that got them into community nonprofits. And then several of them then would have postgraduate professional training, say in psychology, social work, something like that, and then found jobs with gender-based violence nonprofits. That's a very common pathway now for younger men who are getting into paid occupations. Not very well paid occupations, I should add, but ones that make them feel very good about themselves and allow them to make enough money to make a living. Most of the young men of color that we interviewed had a different pathway into the work, and they were, and I should say, Starting in around the 90s, you start seeing a lot more men of color moving into this field, more black men nationally, more Latino men, and that tends to vary regionally, but in the southwest part of the U.S. where I live, lots of young Latino men getting involved. I'll give you an example of one in a moment. But the sensitizing experience for many of these guys, they might have experienced some violence in their childhoods, but usually not of the same sort of what we think of as violence against women, or we define necessarily as gender-based violence. A lot of them have experienced poverty, racism, and some kind of personal and institutional violence, oftentimes street violence. And the guy I'll introduce you to in a minute, it experienced violence both in his family and in the street, making him feel as though there wasn't any real safe place for him and for his brother in the world. In college, and almost all of the people who get involved in this work have college degrees, okay? In college, they may or may not have taken courses in gender studies, many of them not at all, weren't familiar with it in college, but focused on ethnic studies or other kinds of social sciences that look at race and class inequality. And they got involved in campus activism, oftentimes around race, poverty, a few guys who got involved in sort of prison and prisoner activism and support in colleges, and around working with youth gangs in their communities. Out of college, many of them took jobs in prison, law enforcement, social work, and through that, the ones that we ended up interviewing, for instance, working at a prison, one guy said, you know, I kept running groups for guys in prison, and it was support groups for men around alcoholism, and I just kept hearing stories of horrible domestic violence in their background, and I thought, oh, I'm going to make that connection. That's important. So they start making those kinds of connections, and then some of them find their way then into making a career shift into family and sexual violence prevention with boys and men. So here's my example of this. This guy, Gilbert Salazar, who I interviewed, when I interviewed him, he was a 29-year-old young man working with rape prevention education in the Monterey County Rape Crisis Center with an office in Salinas, California. My hometown, by the way, and Salinas, California is an agricultural town in central California, maybe best known if you know your literature as the birthplace of John Steinbeck, the birthplace of Michael Messner, too. I'd like to say Steinbeck and I went to the same high school together, 50 years apart, yeah, Nobel Prize here, but Gilbert Salazar is working in Salinas schools, middle schools, and high schools. When I interviewed him here, and Salinas had become a town that was made up, that had one of the highest poverty rates in the state and one of the highest violence rates per capita in the country. Lots of poverty, lots of gang violence, predominantly Latino population, and many, many first-generation Mexicans. So he's working in a context there that he was very well suited to work in. Because in his background, he's from the LA area, and his pathway was he came from this very poor working class family. There was a lot of community violence in his experience, street violence. There was also violence in his family. He had a younger brother that he was extremely protective of, but he felt very, fraught because he couldn't figure out how to make his brother safe. And so he went away to college and he studied youth violence, and he studied how to create intervention programs for gangs and youth gangs. And it was all about working with young Latino boys in community contexts. And so he took a job in a community nonprofit doing drug and gang rehab, and then he too started to see some of these same kinds of connections about sexual assault, domestic violence, that seemed to be part of the picture of the problems that he was looking at with these boys and their lives and their families. And when a job at the Monterey County Rape Crisis Center opened, he applied and got the job. And, I have a quote from him there saying, sexual violence wasn't my initial focus. I wanted to focus on boys with low socioeconomic status, boys of color, but eventually I got connected to this issue, and he sees those kind of connections. So he gets into this job, and he's working under a statewide umbrella that was called CalCASA, that was running a curriculum that was then called the My Strength Campaign. And the curriculum was created in part by some people in New York City, Men Against Rape, and some of whom were very longtime activists in rape prevention work. But Gilbert Salazar has handed this curriculum, and he's told it, go into the schools, go forth, young men, and turn these boys into good men. And he was not quite sure what to do with this at first. So anyway, let me just say a couple things about these posters. The field has kind of moved beyond the My Strength campaign, but some of the underlying principles are still at work in some of the intervention work that's being done with boys. But I pitch these posters to my students sometimes, and a lot of my students are very savvy about media and advertising, and I understand you have a strong communication media advertising program here as well. And I ask them, like, what do you see here in terms of the conventions of normal advertising images? One of my students said was, well, whoever made these posters didn't seem too comfortable with interracial dating, did they? You know, they had to make these sort of homogeneous pairs. Oh yeah, that's funny, I hadn't even noticed that myself till it was pointed out, because I was looking at something entirely different. What are the sort of conventions here that are very kind of common in gender advertising? And my students were able to sort of see this, you know, pretty clearly. The men, each of them seems to be looking straight out into the camera, right into your eyes, making direct contact with the viewer. The women, even the one in the middle who's also looking out, she's kind of looking wistfully into the distance, you know, she's not looking right at you. The other two are looking adoringly at the man, this one like she's ready to nibble his ear, perhaps. And what these kind of are saying just visually is they're positioning men as in charge, as the sort of subjects of relationships, subjects in the sense of the philosophical term of a subject being one who knows and acts on the world, okay? An object is someone who's known and acted upon. And so a lot of feminists, when they first looked at these images, said, I don't like this because it reproduces this subject-object dichotomy. And women have always been objectified, and men are sort of positioned at the center of the universe as the knowers and the actors and the subjects. This just reproduces that. So there's been a lot of debate about them, but then the people who come back and say, oh, but wait a minute, it's much more clever than that. If you look at the text, and if you look, of course, at the curriculum that these posters are a part of, it's just not just a poster campaign, but it's part of a broader curriculum. What these are actually saying is, yes, you're strong, you're a guy, you know, you're at the center of the universe, you're the one who can be the decider. But at the same time, the text is telling you in each case to listen to the woman, to respect her as a full human being, as also an acting, thinking subject who has desires and who has opinions about what should or shouldn't happen and when it should happen or not happen. So it is using men's sense of being in charge as a way of making them feel comfortable about recognizing the subjectivity of a woman, okay? So anyway, that's kind of what the debate has been about these posters. But I simply asked Gilbert Salazar, you have to use this My Strength campaign. How does it work for you? What do you do? And I had actually interviewed his boss, the head of CalCasa in California, and he was very enthusiastic about the My Strength campaign. He says, it resonates with the kids out there. It's really powerful. I've been to all these different high schools and the curriculum is really working well. Well, this one guy on the ground that I interviewed, at least, Gilbert Salazar, he said, the boys' feedback to the images was not very positive. The images to me seemed very polished. They didn't seem quite, you know, real enough for me. I don't really use them very often. I don't really show them to the boys very often. And he went on to say, don't tell my boss that if you don't mind, but I didn't. But instead, what he was doing was some really innovative things. And this is one of the wonderful things about doing this study is I met these really smart, engaged people who were taking what others had created and given to them and using it if it seemed to work, but were also very innovative. And were taking also account of the populations that they were working with, that sometimes it would work with one group and not with another. And so with the groups that he was working with, he said, you know, What I'm teaching them about masculinity has to encompass all forms of violence, not just sexual violence. Violence, men's violence against other men, other forms of violence as well. He mentioned police violence against the community has to be incorporated into our understanding of what's going on. He told me one of these kids, I'm sure not this one individual, but one kid said to me, oh, you want us to get involved in dealing with trying to stop violence? Maybe you'll help us figure out how to keep the police from being violent against us. And he said, okay, well, let's get that into the conversation. So what Gilbert Salazar did was, instead of just sticking with this curriculum that seemed kind of flat and didn't really work, he drew from what's called theater of the oppressed, which if any of you have read any sort of Latin American theory and philosophy about pedagogy, you might have read a very famous book by Paulo Freire called Pedagogy of the Oppressed. And what Freire did was, with teaching people, peasants, how to read, he developed these methods that he called dialogical methods, where you would go in there as a teacher, not with the idea that you're going to dump this information in their heads, but first learning from them. What are the important issues in their lives? Is it that their water is contaminated? Oh, okay, well, let's create a curriculum around contaminated water so that people will know that it's in their interest to learn to read, and then reading will help them explore the problems in their own world. And so Gilbert Salazar used that as in a somewhat different way, a theater of the oppressed, creating theater with kids in their communities. Oh, are the police an issue in your community? Let's create a performance then where we incorporate that, and then he would pull in also gender-based violence issues and masculinity issues and get the boys and sometimes boys and girls to act these things out for each other. So very creative consciousness-raising activities that would engage the kids. He, not long after I interviewed him, and maybe a year after I interviewed him, he left that job, went back, and suddenly I found him at my university doing a master's program in theater. He completed his master's in theater, and now he's working in the Los Angeles schools trying to implement these ideas in the schools. So really innovative stuff that people are doing. But the point here and the reason for spending some time on him is to think about how his personal roots led him to get pulled into this field that had been created in a certain way, and then to help sort of innovate ways to apply that field to the communities that he is concerned with. Okay, so now the final piece of the talk that I want to spend a few minutes on is thinking about kind of going back to this all men and some men issue. And how we can think about, because lots of times when I talk about these issues, or when anybody talks about sexual violence issues, particularly if we're talking about men's violence against women, which I think it's very important to talk about directly, men sometimes get a little defensive because they feel as though they have the finger pointed at them. Not me, I've never, and I never would, you know, hit a woman. I think it's wrong, I wouldn't tolerate it. And I think that's true, that the vast majority of men never rape women. They never commit a sexual assault. They never commit domestic violence against a woman. However, all of us are part of a culture that in some ways enables the actions of a few. And so to me, the important thing is, how do we all take responsibility for something that really just some men are doing, okay? And when I look at this, I created this continuum, and this is a real sort of off the top of my head gestalt idea of proportions. I don't really know this as a quantitative sociologist, but my sense is that, you know, the proportion of men who are violent perps at any point in their lives, pretty small. Too many though, right? Even one is too many, and there are quite a few. Then there's this group of men that I would call controlling men, a very large and growing number of men that I call good but silent men, and then a small but growing group of men that I call allies. And that's the group that my book is about, is the allies. And the book, in part, chronicles the movement of men into that ally category, from maybe at one point just kind of thinking about themselves as good men. But also, a couple of the men are former perps. There's a couple of men who are really active in the anti-domestic violence field who themselves committed acts of domestic violence earlier in their lives, got into DV programs and became converts and are now very effective trainers. And they say that those men are some of the most effective trainers. Just like if you're in Alcoholics Anonymous or something like that, the most powerful speaker at an AA meeting is someone who really hit bottom and knows exactly where you are or where you've been because they have lived it, right? So I'm going to talk about these four categories. You'll see a lot of text up here for a minute, but I'll move through that pretty quickly. And then I'm going to tell you a story about myself that doesn't make me look all that rosy. So here's the text, and we've got the same continuum running across violent perps, controlling men, good silent men, and allies. And I wanted to say something about the beliefs, words, actions, and outcomes of each of these types. And these are what sociologists call ideal types. Not every man fits perfectly into one of these categories, okay? But this is for trying to understand this sort of continuum in the world. Okay, so the beliefs of violent perps would be a lot of men who I think end up committing acts of violence against women believe in male supremacy. They believe men should be entitled to rule and should have entitlement to women's bodies and to women's labor. Honey, get me a beer. And they oftentimes have a great deal of insecurity about strong and independent women. Thus the sort of defensive aggression, I think, that you see lots of times from men who are violent perps. And you know, it might be summarized best in that sort of, you know, sort of exclamation, "I'm the man," you know. The actions of violent perps are, you know, range from emotional and physical control of women, verbal abuse of women, acts of physical domestic violence and sexual assault, and also joining in and bragging to other men about sexual conquests of women. And the very common outcomes are physical and psychological damage to women, cycles of bad relationships, and sometimes legal troubles as well. So that's not a very pretty picture in just about any way. Now, controlling men, you know, they're close on the continuum here to this side of violent perps, but they are men who maybe haven't, and maybe hopefully never will, commit acts of physical violence against women. However, they might share some of the same sorts of perspectives. Male supremacy and entitlement to women's bodies and labor, but they might also say that men should respect women. And when I say respect women, I think this is something we have to be very careful about. Usually when I hear a man kind of proclaim, you know, too often that he respects women, I think perhaps he protesteth too much. And that what we really have is someone saying, "I respect women," bracket, as long as they stay in their place. They respect a sort of idealized vision of what a woman should be. And it reflects this old Madonna whore dichotomy that we see in literature. Even my wonderful favorite, you know, hero, John Steinbeck, does a little Madonna whore imagery in some of his old novels of the 1930s. And the Madonna whore imagery is that women are put into one of two categories, the Madonna being the woman you put on the pedestal and you adore her, she's like your mother, she's often desexualized, and you'll do anything to protect her. The whore is the woman who's in the gutter and you defile her and you think she deserves everything she gets, including your own abuse, okay? So women are put in one of those two kinds of categories, and it's sort of unrealistic, of course, in the real world to think of a woman in, you know, neatly fitting totally in either one, right? So the actions of controlling men are also similarly emotional, verbal control, sexual pressure, intimidation of women, and a potential for violence. And controlling men also will often also, just as violent perps do, join in kind of bragging and about sexual conquests of women. And the outcome is psychological damage to women and also bad relationships. Now, good silent men, which I think is this growing category of men that I'm excited about meeting and excited I'm seeing more and more of these guys in my classes, they believe that hitting women is wrong. They believe and have really incorporated the feminist ideals that full consent in a sexual encounter is always necessary for sex. And they believe that a man should respect a woman and not just sort of say, "Nobody respects women more than I do," but to respect a woman truly as an equal, as a fully human subject that's equal with everyone else. Okay, good men would often say to, I would never hit or rape a woman, and mean it, and most likely, in most cases, live that, okay, that they would never do that. Their actions are that they would usually feel good about their relationships with women. However, they tend to be silent in male groups when they hear sexist talk or when they hear bragging about sexual conquests of women. They just won't say anything because maybe they don't want to make others or themselves uncomfortable. So they might look the other way when they find themselves in a situation where women are being hit upon or harassed by men and thinking, it's not me, I wouldn't do that. So the outcome of that is that they, even though individually are not going to damage or hurt women, that as part of a culture, they're contributing to a culture of silence about men's violence against women that actually enables those violent perps and controlling men to continue doing what they're doing. And as long as the people controlling men and violent perps don't hear anything from other men, they might just consider that all men are like them, okay? So the important thing then in my mind is, how do we think about becoming more active allies? Because allies believe that not only like the silent good men are, that individually they have to be responsible for having respectful and egalitarian relationships with women, but also that they have a social responsibility with other men to try to talk about and stop violence against women and to create conditions for gender equality with women. An ally might say, it is my responsibility not just to not be violent, but to help stop other men's violence against women. And he would, in terms of his actions, hold himself and other boys and men accountable about sexual consent and about responsible bystander behavior. Now, I want to give you a little bit of an example in a minute about bystander behavior, but bystander behavior has become one of the keys to sexual violence prevention on college campuses and in the military and other places where sports teams, where professionals are intervening and trying to get men to think about their responsibility. And the idea of bystander behavior is like, what do you do? You know, if you're at a party with your guy, you're at a party with your male friends and you see a woman who's gotten really drunk and you see two of your friends, maybe they're your teammates or your fraternity brothers, and you see two or three guys tugging her and pulling her out of the room into a bedroom door. What do you do? You know, maybe a good silent man would just shrug and look the other way, but what does an ally do, okay? So the work of allies then aims to create a culture of shared responsibility among men to stop violence against women. Now, in the example that I'm going to give you here, the story, I'm going to highlight actions here, which I've lit up about bragging and, you know, joining in or not joining in, saying something or not saying something. And the story that I want to tell you is a story that I experienced when I was a new professor, fresh out of graduate school, and I was off at one of my first professional conferences, which just so happened to be in Las Vegas, Nevada, a strange place to have a professional meeting, I should add. It's probably a strange place in almost any other way as well, but especially to have a professional conference. And these photographs are just tugged off of the internet randomly. I don't know these people at all. But the story, they help you visualize the story a little bit. I went, after the meetings one evening, I went off with these three guys, one of whom I knew a little bit through the telephone and writing letters for email. And we had shared interests in sociology. And the other two guys were just a couple of other sociologists. And all three of them were a little older than me and a little better established. I was kind of the new guy just breaking in, really wanted, you know, I kind of knew a couple of them. I knew their work. I'd read them a little bit. And I hadn't published anything. There's no way they'd know anything about me. So I really wanted to make a good impression and get into their good graces. So we're at a bar in Vegas. You know, you can hear all of the slot machines ding, ding, dinging. And we're talking, having a beer. We weren't having a beer yet. We're empty-handed because the waitress walks up to us holding one of those little things and, you know, trays and asks us if we want a drink. We all say yes, and she's dressed, you know, kind of similarly to the way this woman is dressed. She's, you know, got a very low cut top. She's got a very, very short skirt. She's got heels on, and she's made up, and your hair is looking very made up and everything. And she's, you know, youngish, and so we all say, sure, yeah, I'd like this, I'd like that, please. And as she's walking away, she's not, you know, between here and that speaker from us yet. She's just barely gotten away from us. And one of the guys says pretty loudly, like, God, did you see those boobs? Did you see those boobs? And she's walking away, you know, 50-50, pretty good chance she can hear that, but she just keeps walking. And then the other guy says, well, she's further away, probably can't hear this now. Well, you know, yeah, she had great tits, but what I'm looking at is those legs. And of course, by now, all four of us are turning and looking at her walking away. What I'm looking at is those legs. I'd love to have those wrapped around me. Okay, so in my mind, things are going 100 miles an hour, right? What do I say? And, you know, not that long ago at this point, I was a jock. I know how to participate if I want to in that kind of banter. I could easily, and honestly, it popped into my mind, what I easily could have said back was to the guy who said the thing about her legs, oh, dream on, buddy. You know, she was staring right at my crotch. She wouldn't go with you, you know, that sort of thing. But no, I'm not going to say that. I'm not going to say that because I have already come to understand that kind of talk among men, which doesn't necessarily always result in violence against women directly. It is, however, a dynamic that's very similar to the dynamic in gang rapes, where in this case, it's verbal and symbolic. We're using this woman's body and sexualized talk about her body parts to bond with each other and feel good about each other. And it's an erotic bond, but it's a heterosexual erotic bond that precludes that anything homosexual might be happening with the four of us. And we're kind of using her in that way to connect with each other in this kind of safe, heterosexual, kind of manly way, okay? Now, in group sexual assaults, we know from studies of fraternity gang rapes and so forth, there's similar dynamics where women are treated as not just symbolic objects, but real physical objects through which men, you might argue, have sex with each other. And it's not sex with her, she's just a defiled object through which the men are kind of violently having sex with each other, or connecting erotically with each other, if you want to put it that way. So that kind of talk, which I think sort of falls kind of into this category, can and does slide in this direction, and I know that, so I'm not going to participate in that. So what do I say, though? I want these guys to like me. I don't want to be the killjoy here. I don't want to be the guy who they think, oh, God, you know, we're not going to ever go out with him again. And so the other thing that pops into my head is the opposite of the end of the continuum, which is to say, God, I just met you guys. I didn't know you were such sexists. No, I'm not going to say that. It's the killjoy thing to say. So what do I say? Well, I end up saying nothing because I think I probably, to this day, I'm not sure, but I think I probably was just going to shrug and say nothing, kind of, you know, something that might communicate that I want to change the subject, but certainly not something that I'm going to, you know, interrupt what's been said. But my friend Don Sabo, who then ends up becoming a very close friend and guy I did a bunch of research with down the road, he jumps in and says something. And he's a little more seasoned than I am. And he's been involved in men and feminist issues for a little bit longer than I have at this time. And he says to them, in this very friendly, matter-of-fact sort of way, he says, huh, you know, when I look at her, what I see is probably a woman who's, you know, working nights here to make a little extra money because she might have a day job at Mickey D's or something, and they pay them so poorly. So she has to come work here at night, and she might be a mother. She might be, you know, having to earn that extra money because she's a young mother and she's trying to take care of her family and she's got the only income in her family. And, you know, you guys are checking out her body. She looks like a little too slim to me, like maybe she has to keep her weight down to squeeze into that outfit that her employers make her wear for our benefit. And I'm thinking, wow, that's quite an intervention there, what he just said. And the other two guys, there's a kind of moment of silence, you know, but it was very artful, I thought, what he did, because he used his understanding as a sociologist to imagine her as a full human being, somebody who's a member of a family, somebody who's got a job, right? And lo and behold, one of the other guys who had just been talking about her breasts, you know, says, "Oh yeah, you know, my sister, she worked in a fast food place, and they paid shit. You know, it's a horrible, horrible job." And then he gets into this whole empathy thing for women in their workplaces. So to me, this was a great example of how men in their everyday lives, and I've tried to emulate that sort of tone whenever I can, how boys and men in our everyday lives can intervene in situations and create conversations that broaden all of our consciousness without cutting off conversations or putting each other down or coming across as the gender cop in the room. And it seems to me that I put this up here as an example of bystander behavior, because lots of times people think of bystander behavior like what I mentioned to you a few minutes ago. You know, you're at the party, the woman's being dragged out of the room. Lots of times when men are first introduced into thinking about being responsible bystanders, they kind of think of themselves as Superman, you know? Run into the phone booth, put on your cape, come flying out and save the day, you know, save the damsel in distress, and even if it means you have to put your dukes up. Most bystander behavior is not like that. Most bystander behavior is about little things that happen in everyday life. How can you intervene in situations that you know are connected to broader systems of oppression and violence? And that takes some education, it takes some thinking, it takes some guts, oftentimes, like my friend Don Sabo showed. But if you do it well and you do it right, you can do it in ways that create new kinds of bonds among men rather than severing them, or just falling into the old kind of bonding that isn't very healthy for men either. So I think at the interpersonal level, what I would encourage you to think about doing is trying to find moments in your everyday life where you can expand the conversations that you're a part of. You know, call into question some of the kinds of things that people are saying in ways that are friendly but somewhat confrontational as well. At the broader social level, I think, you know, we can get back to, we're maybe already back at a time when we might be thinking about some of the sort of work that I was studying this book is reconnecting to broad national and regional and local social movements. I was moved by the Women's March in Los Angeles, in part not just because of the participation of men, which I'm always interested in, but by the gatherings of multiple age groups of people, older women, my age and older, you know, who are carrying signs saying, "I can't believe I have to protest this shit still." And then younger people, like the people we see up here, who I think were really seriously moving into positions of leadership. What a relief for some of the older folks that I interviewed in the book, who sometimes feel as though they're carrying this load and they can't put it down because nobody else is going to pick it up. The load is being picked up by a new generation of people now, and they're doing it differently. They have their own sorts of issues that they're bringing in and connecting, but it's very, very encouraging to see. So thinking about at the everyday level of interactions with your friends in your groups, up to big political, national, or regional mobilizations, there's also a middle ground that you might think about, and that is getting involved, or at least finding out what's going on with your local organizations in your community and on your campus. And there's a couple things that I want to mention here that I've just learned about today. One from Kendall. Where are you, Kendall? Okay, Kendall here has told me today about the family abuse services of Alamance County, and how she and others are recruiting volunteers here on campus, and you can contact her at fas@elon.edu, FAS, and that's Kendall. And Kendall, do you want to say something real quick about that? Sure. Thank you. And then there's a representative of your campus office who I met at dinner this evening. Yes, please come up and have a...
Hi, so I'm Becca. I'm with the Health Promotion Department on campus, and so we have a lot of different opportunities to get involved, whether that's with student organizations like One Love. Do we have anybody from One Love here? Space, Effect, Sparks, Beyond Masculinity. So if you're interested, I have a sign up outside, and just put your name and email down and I'll get you more information. We also have some representatives from Crossroads, our Sexual Assault Response and Resource Center here, and they will be in the back as well for more information on how to get involved.
And Becca was telling me about the Beyond Masculinity group that's trying to get going on campus here, and that's exactly the kind of group that I've been studying on different campuses. It's the type of group that a lot of the men that I studied kind of routed through as they got involved in the community organizations and ended up getting jobs working in anti-violence work. But even if you don't end up doing that as a career, there are a lot of young men who do that sort of work on campuses for a little while, and it becomes a very, very important part of their lives. Some of the older men that I interviewed who only did that kind of work for 2, 3, 4, 5 years when they were very young men, when they're in their 60s and even pushing 70, and I interviewed them, they said that turned out to be one of the most important and valuable experiences that they had in their whole life, just doing that for a few years while they were young, because it set a kind of emotional and intellectual template for everything else that they did, other kinds of jobs they ended up getting, and they felt so good about having done that kind of work, and it contributed so much to their own personal growth. So I encourage you to connect up with either these organizations or others that are existing on campus. So I've given you like three different levels of thinking about engagement. One is just at the everyday interpersonal level, one is at the local organizational level, and one is thinking about national politics and large organizations. And I know that's absolutely more than you can bite off, and so I'm going to stop at this moment. I'm happy to answer any questions or hear your ideas, and I really appreciate, once again, the invitation and your kind attention. Thank you.